our heads and hearts in prayer. Our Father in heaven, it is a great privilege and also a terrifying responsibility to attempt to bring your word to your people and to apply it in a meaningful and helpful way. But we are grateful that you have promised that all scripture is God-breathed and useful for teaching and rebuking and correcting and training in righteousness, that the person of God may be fully equipped for every good work. We pray, O God, then, by your Spirit who inspired this your word, you would now tutor each of us in our inner hearts and minds, that we might know how we ought to apply this and how we ought to live in repentant lives that depend on you for your wonderful grace and mercy. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. The text I have just read to you is probably one of the most unforgettable, most riveting, and most heartbreaking chapters to be found anywhere in the Bible. It is almost unbearable even to reflect on it. And I'm sure that there are many in the congregation, as I was reading, are feeling deeply distressed, even imagining what this is all about and how it might resonate with our own fallen experiences. You know, it is the case that the name Tamar is actually one of the most popular names among Israeli girls at this time. And part of it, I suppose, is the beauty of the name. It's a word that means date palm, one of the most lovely trees that's so useful for its fruit. So a lot of good associations. But really, the reason for the name's popularity is this story. And it's not because many young Israeli women want to follow in the example of a tragic victim such as Tamar, but because they see into the story an evidence of an extraordinary heroic person who stood up against her attacker and spoke the truth to someone who refused to listen and did not in any way compromise that truth with respect to her own experience. Sin is complicated, and that's got to be our starting point as we look at this passage, or we'll think it's all about someone else. There's a complexity about sin that makes it difficult for us to understand. Of course, our chapter could easily be retitled, "The Life-Destroying Effects of the Evil of Sin." But it isn't just the evil, it's also getting an account of what is the actual offense here and what actually is going on. When I was first at seminary, I bought this series of volumes by G.C. Burkhauer, one of the best of the Dutch theologians in the last century. And it's a bookshelf-long series of volumes on the major topics of our faith. Here is his book on righteousness. You see this skinny little book? This book that has less than 200 pages, and it's all like large print. You can probably read some of the words from where you're sitting. Almost, no footnotes on that page, no footnotes on that. Oh, there's one on that. Practically no footnotes. That's because righteousness is simple. Righteousness makes sense in God's universe. We're wired for righteousness. When we follow in the paths of righteousness, life works well. This is his volume on sin. This volume, you can see by the thickness, it's just under 1,000 pages, and I can't even read it. It's very fine print. And on virtually every page, well, here's a page where the footnotes go up half the page. Footnotes galore in even tinier print. Why is that? Well, that's because sin is complicated. And at the end of reading almost 1,000 pages, Burkhauer's conclusion is, sin cannot be explained. I wish I'd read that at the beginning. But I've never forgotten the lesson. Sin makes no sense. It's self-destructive. It's contrary to the nature God has worked into the warp and woof of his universe. We're constantly running in cross purposes. We're a contradiction even to ourselves, inexplicable to others. Well, any case, that's an overview of our chapter. It is a complicated passage, and you should expect it to be, because it's about sin. We could also title it, by the way, like Father, like Son, or Visiting the Iniquity of the Father upon the Children, because, as you know, the precursor to this is David's own fall, his sin, into an illicit sexual relationship with Bathsheba, who was unwilling, and also an attempt to cover up through murder, through the murder of Uriah the Hittite, Bathsheba's husband, but also the murder of other innocent people. Well, that's going to get played out. That horrible example will be played out in David's children, starting with his firstborn named Amnon. You're going to see it actually defines what happens in all the chapters after this, right up through chapter 20 of this book. It's all a mirror image with various permutations of David's sin. He's looking in the mirror when he looks at his children. We'll talk about that whole issue on another occasion. But how did it start? Well, here's the complexity part. It isn't a simple picture of all black. There's some white mixed in with the black, even in Amnon. Or at least you should be reading it in the same way that Tamar read Amnon. She didn't see him as utterly evil to start with, and we shouldn't, because the narrator doesn't. It starts in verse 1. In the course of time, Amnon, son of David, fell in love with Tamar, the beautiful sister of Absalom, son of David. I know you're listening to this with jaundiced ears, because you know how it comes out. You're thinking the word love is just a euphemism for lust. It isn't. It's nowhere used that way. It is actually used in Hebrew 217 times. And if you check out a concordance of all those uses, you find that, well, yes, on occasion, what you love is not correct. For example, on one occasion in Isaiah chapter 1, loving bribery is condemned. You can love the wrong thing, but it's still love. It's mostly love about God, mostly love for others, and God's love for us everywhere else. Hebrew has a very rich vocabulary for lust. There are actually four different verbs that are translated lust. One sometimes burn with lust, it's related to the word for heat. Another, lust in the sense of desire, comes from the verb for desire. There's another verb, lusting after, that's related to the word for prostitution in the Old Testament. And then there's a fourth word, lust. None of those words are used. Love is what's used. Lexical choice allows us to know that the author means you to understand that Amnon loved Tamar, not that this is all lust by another name. Now, I know that's a hard sell for you. You're not really sure just having heard that, although I will tell you every single Bible in English translates it love, fell in love, that something about came to love, was in love with. Those are all the ones I found. It's all about love, any way the Bible's translated. Well, you say, but wait a minute, it mentions Tamar's beauty, doesn't that? Does that give you kind of a creepy feeling that he noticed she was beautiful? And I would say, well, if you look at the rest of the Old Testament, it works out the same way. Abraham mentioned how Sarah is beautiful. He was worried about what the men would think in Egypt because she was 65 and such a knockout. I'm sure Sarah would have said to him, come on, Abraham, I know. That's just because you love me. You're married to me. Naturally, I am fetching to you, but don't think everyone else is going to get all excited. It's said of her because, well, that's actually how she looked to him. Jacob, likewise, it's said of Rachel that she was beautiful in form and appearance, and for him, it made it easy to work 7 years in order to marry her. Was that all based on lust? I don't know. I do a fair amount of marriage counseling, particularly in earlier times, premarital counseling. One of my favorite questions to start with is just name, 12 to 15 reasons why you love this girl. And I have my notebook out, and, the guy is thinking, well, let me see. She has such amazing insights about the Bible. Okay, we write that down. She loves it when the sermons go long, and you know, whatever. And you know, we go down this big long list, and at the end I say, well, wait a minute, you didn't mention how attractive she is. You know, well, I'm a minister, you know, you're not supposed to think those thoughts, I guess. I don't know. And so he didn't want me to think ill of him. Can you imagine marrying someone that you don't like looking at? I mean, that doesn't make sense. So you should be able to affirm, geez, this woman is gorgeous. Now, that does not work in reverse. In all studies done of women's views of men, most of us come below average. I don't know how that's statistically possible, but anyway, there are a few men that women find universally attractive, but they're not even necessarily interested in marrying them. Thankfully for those of us who are subpar. In any case, you know, so I don't say, beautiful sister, fine. That's perfectly okay. That doesn't mean he's got some untoward motive at this point. He's lovesick. You know, he's looking like a wretch every morning. He can't get any sleep. He doesn't feel like eating. You know, some of you, I have experienced this lovesickness. In fact, I've seen it in my students at seminary. I used to keep track of when they got married in order to record and prove my theory, which is all students do better once they get married. Your GPA goes up. Because before you're married, you're just constantly in a tiz. You can't stand being alone. And when can we get together at, you know, at Starbucks? And your life is a wreck until you get married. And then it all kind of fits together. And it's a different kind of wreck, but it's sort of a different, you know, anyway. Well, I didn't mean to make jokes out of this, but in any case, I know it says that because it seemed impossible for him to do anything to her. That's because the translators know how the story comes out. In fact, the expression here is translated exactly like in earlier in 1 Samuel when Saul is worried about his son. Saul's father is worried about Saul because he's been gone too long looking for the donkeys that ran away. And then the father says, "What shall I do to my son?" No, they always translate, "What shall I do about my son?" I'd say the best translation is he's sick and he doesn't know what to do about her. He wants to meet her, but they didn't have eharmony.com. There's no possibility of a lunch break. And she now she's called a virgin, which just means she's now of marriageable age. And because she's of marriageable age, she's in seclusion. She's living in a separate house from where he is. And there's no opportunity to have unchaperoned or even in most cases, even chaperoned get together. And I'm going to give him the benefit of the doubt at this point. And so he comes up with an idea. Well, I think I'm going to surprise her I know she's going to that movie at Lowe's. I'm going to show up there. Now, is that a deception? I guess it is. But you don't yet know whether the deception is intended just so you can have a gathering or whether there's some real malevolent purpose in all of this. In any case, yeah, he has a Jonadab friend that shows the danger of being wise without moral principle. It'd be better to be stupid. Jonadab gives him a plan, and actually it does set up a situation which he takes full advantage of, and we know this. But Tamar doesn't know it yet. In any case, I'm still going to insist that he starts out with love. Why? Well, he uses the word himself. He says, "I'm in love with Tamar," but he doesn't say this to her. This isn't one of his pickup lines that he uses on all the girls. He tells it to Jonadab, "I'm in love with her." And there's no reason for him to mean anything other than love in that context. Likewise, the narrator, who knows all, who knows how the story comes out, the narrator, the writer, the author, is saying this, that he loves Tamar in the opening verse. Amnon fell in love with Tamar. That's the narrator. You should trust the narrator in literature and scripture as well. And even more, at the end, in verse 15, listen to what he writes. "Then Amnon hated her with intense hatred. In fact, he hated her more than he had loved her." The antithetical parallelism here means that love inverted into hate. And the hatred is greater than the love. It's got to be the opposite of the love. So that if the hate is evil, the love must not have been. Isn't that convincing? I think that's a pretty good argument. We start with love. And you say, well, why emphasize that, Gordon? This is such a vile story. Well, because that's the nature of sin, and actually it even explains more the deep wound caused by Amnon. If someone hates you, does something hateful to you, it's not too hard to blow it off. If the guy's, the woman or whatever, or your boss is hates you, and you know it, and then they treat you in a hateful way, well, what else did you expect? What makes this particularly heartbreaking and grievous is that he loved her, and he is doing something now terribly hateful as the story unfolds. It's the same kind of inversion that happens with, unfortunately, in modern circumstance in the case of divorce. Now you can say, well, if they did such a hateful thing now, they must always have hated me. I wish it were that simple. Unfortunately, there are a lot of people who love others that then do terribly hateful things in spite of actual, some real love. It's a mixture. It's complicated. It takes lots of pages to figure it out and then say, I can't figure it out. The conclusion then is there's some ambiguity and subtlety here. And when we are thinking about Amnon, then we are at least mirroring something of the confusion that Tamar might rightly have felt, because she had many reasons to assume that he actually did have feelings for her, and she does assume them. Otherwise, she wouldn't waste her breath trying to persuade him to do something other than what he's planning. You would think that love has no part even at the beginning, but the book of Samuel has lots of these stories of love becoming hate. This isn't the only one. There's the story of Saul and his relationship with David. Saul, it is said in 1 Samuel 16:21, greatly loved David. At the beginning, he loved him with a great love. I mean, it's a very strong description, even though some of our Bibles downplay it a bit. But read in the ESV and you'll get it all straight up. He loved him greatly, and he hated him greatly later. And same with Michael, poor David. Michael, his wife, the Bible tells us that she, before they got married, loved David, and it pleased Saul to hear this. But later on, she hated him and loathed him, despised him in her heart when she saw him dancing before the Lord. Love can turn into hate. Don't you think otherwise? Maybe some of you have even experienced it. It didn't mean the love wasn't there. It meant the hate needed to be repented of and rebuked. There's a second problem with our story, not just the complexity, but also, as I read it, it stirs up all kinds of repugnant feelings because of the appearance of incest, complicating, as it even making worse, if possible, the sexual abuse. Incest because, well, we read about brother and sister. In fact, the approach that Amnon takes is to invite his sister, my sister, you know, lie with me. And so it looks like incest. Tamar, my sister. The problem with this is that actually Hebrew, unfortunately, does not give us vocabulary to distinguish full siblings from half siblings from step siblings. A brother is a brother is a brother, whether it's a full brother, a half brother, or a step brother, or an adopted brother. The language does not distinguish at all. So Hebrew uses circumlocutions because it turns out it's important to know whether you shared the same mother and father, or whether you shared one of your parents with this brother or sister, or shared no parent and no biological shared ancestry with this other person who happened to have been adopted into the family. I'd like to argue that, in fact, the brother-sister business, the way it's talked about, is in this case a step situation, an adoptive situation, and therefore there is actually no blood or a fine affinity between Amnon and Tamar. How do we know this? Well, the text starts by showing us brother or sister language used two different ways. In the course of time, Amnon, son of David, fell in love with Tamar. You're expecting to hear the daughter of David by parallelism. But it doesn't say that. In fact, nowhere is Tamar ever called the daughter of David. And nowhere does David or described as having being the father of David, father of Tamar. It is a very surprising thing that Tamar, every time she's spoken of, is only spoken of as a sister to Absalom and by extension, a half-sister or whatever to Amnon or to others, or sister to all of her brothers, all of her siblings. Why does this matter? Well, it matters because in the Old Testament, in Leviticus chapter 18, Leviticus chapter 20, in Deuteronomy chapter 27, we have innumerable long lists of texts prohibiting sexual relations within family. Whether you are a father-in-law or brother-in-law, whether it's an affine or whether it's a consequent, whether it's your biological father or not, all these relationships are prohibited. But one that is not prohibited is between a brother and a stepsister who shares no common parent or ancestry. That's not prohibited. And incidentally, by the way, because Christians were primarily responsible for the laws of our U.S. of A. states, every single state in the Union does actually allow marriage to a stepsister or brother, not to a stepson or father, or in terms of intergenerational marriage, but to a stepsister, because it's just reflecting what was the practice here. Abraham and Sarah are a good example of this. Some of you know the story of Abraham and Sarah, where Abraham speaks of Sarah not as his full sister, and some people thought or think that it's speaking of her as a half-sister, but in fact she was most likely, based on what we know of parallels throughout the ancient Near East, an adopted sister. Where does this adoption come from? Well, it happens in a case like Esther, the story of Esther in Mordecai. The Bible tells us that Esther's parents died, and her uncle very generously took her in as a younger woman, but no, we're not talking about a baby, and she became a daughter to him, so now he was responsible for her. And the Bible just calls her a daughter, even though she's not a daughter. She is an adopted daughter. She is a stepdaughter, or a daughter that did not have either Mordecai or his wife as a parent biologically. This was very common across the ancient Near East because of the high mortality rates, and many examples we now have from Nuzi and other places in Mesopotamia, where individuals would adopt a young girl because of her destitute parents, take care of her, and then she would be able to marry the son of that family. And undoubtedly, Tamar must have been like this. In 1 Chronicles chapter 3, we have a list of 19 of David's sons and all the mothers who bore them. And after the 19 sons, it says all these were sons of David, in addition to sons by concubines. And Tamar was, we're expecting his daughter. But no, again, it says Tamar was their sister. All those different brothers by all those different mothers, she's just their sister because she was adopted into the family. Why do I make a point of this? It's because I want to believe what Tamar actually says. In the press of the time when Amnon was trying to press his interests on her, what does Tamar say as a way of response? After rebuking him, she says, here's the remedy. Please speak to the king. He will not keep me from being married to you. If, in fact, they were in an incestuous relationship, that would not have been permitted, and Amnon would know it. Tamar is being very faithful to biblical ethics in all the things she says. I think this is actually a bona fide offer, actually, of marriage. She read in the books that men tend to be a little more aggressive in their sexual impulses, and, you know, so you fine, you know, she's not offended that he's interested in having a consensual relationship. Lie with me, my sister. But don't do it. No, she says, you cannot do this, but ask Dad. Now, I know there are some who will say, well, that is a terrified girl thinking of something to say to get out of there. Undoubtedly, she could have thought of those things. She could have said, well, Amnon, I didn't know you felt this way about me. Let me slip into something more comfortable. Or how about, let's have a glass of wine and, you know, enjoy the moment. And she could have thought of a lot of things. The only way this works is if she thinks that that's really what Amnon wants. The only way it works is if she knows and Amnon knows that, yeah, it's plausible. David, who knows the Bible inside and out, might agree. And the only way he could agree is if she is, in fact, a stepsister in any case. So now let's get down to the big point. Although, of course, those things are terrible. You know, I mean, we know how it's not that incest doesn't deserve a lot of attention. It's just that I'm arguing this is not the case here. And the language of my brother, my sister, that is used here, we know that's common in biblical poetry for expressions of love between lovers, actually. So it's supposed to be tender language. You get that in the Song of Songs. You have stolen my heart, my sister, my bride. So here's the husband talking to the Shulamite maiden, calling her his sister. It was typical of husbands and wives. I mean, we might use darling or dumpling or I don't know what word you use. They used brother, sister. They enjoyed using that, usually with my in front of it. My love, you know, something like that. So when he says, lie with me, my sister, come to the bed with me, my sister in the NIV, don't my brother. They're using love language. They are using love language. Well, then, was her statement a ploy? I'd say no. She was actually providing an alternative. And you don't have to be a theologian to realize from her what she says that it would be unthinkable for her to agree to premarital sex. It's hard for us to imagine that after we've been brainwashed by public life now for several decades, where more than 90% of all sexual acts on television are portrayed as having taken place between unmarried persons, and they're always portrayed as exciting and healthy and, you know, vital. And after a while, you think, well, this is totally normal. But if you just put yourself back to when the Beatles were formed in 1960, back in the year when the CDC approved for the first time oral contraception, the pill, and I'm not arguing against some of the good that came from the use of the pill, including a massive diminution of unwanted children. But nevertheless, the invention of the pill in 1960, which marks the beginning of the so-called sexual revolution, don't think that didn't have amazing effect. A pill, for the very first time, a medication approved that was to be given and taken by regularly by women that had nothing to do with helping someone who is sick. Perfectly well people were taking this. And suddenly the effect of it was to change. Well, in 1960, I was heading into middle school. The median age for marriage was 23 years of age for men and 20 years old for girls, for women. So premarital sex, we're talking about basically teens. In that year, a survey was done, and 80% of adult respondents in America responded that premarital sex was morally wrong. Morally wrong, 80%. 15 years later, 1975, 80% dropped down to 30%. I mean, there was amazing, and so now, we don't know, do we now finally have it right, and they were all uptight before? Or we got our brains scrambled now, and we have no idea what ethics are really about on this particular subject. There is a way that seems right to a man, but in the end it leads to death, Proverbs warns us. If you believe Tamar, don't do this wicked thing, is even though he's invited consensual relationship, she will not have it. In any case, he refused to listen to her, and since he was stronger than she, the Bible says, NIV, he raped her. Literally, he forced himself on her, and he slept with her. The CDC tells us that 20% of adult American women have had this dreadful experience, either an attempted rape or an actual rape. It can't possibly be the case that, as we preach about, we're not thinking of examples in our own experience that make it incredibly hard even to even read this and think about it. And you wonder, well, we know what he should have done. He shouldn't have done that. He should have waited and asked mom and dad, or dad, if we can get married. Having refused to do that, he then does this. And now the question is, well, is it rape? And it turns out in the Bible, what makes rape rape is not the use of force, but the lack of consent. And the lack of consent is all based on a woman's testimony in Scripture. And the Bible gives the woman the right to define and to testify to whether she gave consent or not. And we're going to look at texts that show us that that's the case. But he wouldn't, in any case, agree, and he clearly did force himself on her. And then the Bible tells us, let's see, what should he have done after he made the second mistake? Not marrying, but enforcing his passions on her, and now what does he do? The Bible says, then Amnon hated her with intense hatred. In fact, he hated her more than he loved her, had loved her. Amnon said to her, get up and get out. Everyone agrees he shouldn't hate her. But there are many who agree with Amnon about the remedy. There are those who, even pastors, will tell Amnon, that's what happened. This relationship was made in the gutter. You need to get rid of this woman. You need to start fresh and do it God's way. There are churches that if they find out that a couple have been living together, they will not allow them to have a wedding in the church because they're just somehow or other, this would validate it. So actually, they'd say, you ought to break up and do something else. Start fresh in with another person, another man, another woman, more worthy. That's not what the Bible says, and that's not what Tamar says, and we need to listen to her wisdom. Her wisdom is, this is even worse than the other. Throwing me out, slamming the door shut, and of course the hatred that was behind it. Some of you know the Stanley Milgram experiments in the 1960s that explain this strange thing, how love can turn to hate when you do something hateful. Milgram was trying to explain, he who grew up with family members that were survivors of the death camps of Nazi Germany, he was trying to explain how it is that such hateful things could be done and why such hateful things were said about the Jews. And he actually came up with an experiment that showed that when you trick someone or coax someone into administering a 450 lethal dose of electricity, or so you think, to a subject that you think is supposed to learn vocabulary or do some learning experiment, that those who are coaxed into actually applying what they thought was a lethal dose of electricity would commonly start disparaging the person they'd never met, who they were electrocuting, they thought, inside the test subject room that this person was supposedly... And they would start saying, what a stupid person! Why aren't they learning? And then with every wrong answer, they were to turn up the voltage a little bit more. You end up hating the person you are acting hateful toward. The emotion is in a vicious cycle of hate based on the actions of hate. It started with love. It got inverted to uncontrolled passion. It became a hateful act, and now he hates her. He blames her. Maybe she ruined his morals, or who knows what's going on in his twisted mind, but he wants to get rid of her and throw her out. And what should she do? Well, of course, she has options now. She can testify to what happened, and now that makes this a capital offense. The Old Testament has this idea about rape. If it happens where there are witnesses, well, of course, the witness testimony needs to be taken account. But if it happens out in the country, Deuteronomy 22 tells us, a man finds a girl, rapes her, only the man who has done this shall die. Do nothing to the girl, it says. She has committed no sin deserving of death. This case is like that of someone who attacks and murders his neighbor. In the Old Testament, rape was viewed as akin to murder. It is an act of violence against an innocent victim. For the man found the girl in the country, and there was no one to rescue her. Some of us are aware of the liberating insight that this is, because there are many who, like Tamar, speak of being disgraced or feeling shame in the aftermath of an action like this. Do nothing because the case is like someone who attacks and murders his neighbor. Oh, there should be someone who's ashamed, namely Amnon, the rapist, the murderer. But she speaks of her shame, and it's the shame of humiliation, of having been the object of someone else's abuse and attack. You know, and sometimes we add to it as well. I have a friend who was gang raped going out into the woods on one occasion, and her mother actually said to her, "Well, why did you go out there alone?" As if that were her fault. As if somehow or other she, by doing that, is complicit or giving consent to what happened. No, someone who attacks and murders her neighbor, that's what rape is like. "How can I get rid of my humiliation or my disgrace?" she asks in verse 13. Well, the only way I know how to get rid of such humiliation is to turn to the one who knows about that kind of suffering. Jesus, who quotes Psalm 69 on the cross as he died for our sins, says, "You know how I am scorned, disgraced, and shamed. All my enemies are before you." Christ was crucified having been stripped naked so that he might be even more humiliated in his sufferings. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, Hebrews says, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Jesus endured shame that he did not deserve. For those of us who need his redemptive work, because we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with us in our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted and tested in every way as we are, yet was without sin. What should she do? Well, she shouldn't be ashamed of that which Amnon should be ashamed of. What could have happened? How could the story, replay the tape, how could it have turned out differently? Well, first of all, he could have in fact spoken to David, and David would not have kept him from being married to Tamar. Apparently he wasn't willing to do that. We ought to be warned about this. Paul writes in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, "This is the will of God, your sanctification, that you abstain from unchastity, that each of you know how to take a wife for himself in holiness and honor, and not in the passion of lust like the heathen who do not know God." Forcing your intentions on a woman is no way to get married. It's no way even, frankly, to consummate a marriage. I have a friend who's in ministry. He had never slept with anyone before their marriage. She had never had relations with anyone. And I don't know where he got it into his head, but on after the wedding, after the reception, both exhausted, they're in the hotel, and he decided that, I don't know whether he thought it was funny or what, but he attacked her. He comes into the bedroom and jumps on her, and it was terrifying to her. It took weeks for her to get over that. So even if you're totally pure as driven snow in terms of your marital intention, it is totally inconsiderate to approach a woman in this way. This is, well, anyway, he learned it. And apparently the pagans liked that, the rape of the Sabines and all that. They seemed to think that was funny or shows you're manly or that you have lots of testosterone. That's not how we are to do it. You're to abstain from unchastity. Each of you should take a wife for himself in holiness and honor, not in passion or lust. The honeymoon should come after the wedding, not before. The Bible does not say you should marry your rapist once it happens. That's not what it says. A passage in Deuteronomy 22 has sometimes been misinterpreted in that way. But no, this is a borderline case. We might call it a date rape. There was a context of affection. There was the statement that at least at first Amnon loved her, though that got twisted and warped into something horrible. But he wasn't a serial rapist. He wasn't attacking women, jumping at him from behind, and he's just looking for his latest victim, who was Tamar. It wasn't that. It was twisted, it was evil, but it wasn't that. On the other hand, Tamar clearly cared for him. Tamar actually loved him. She ministers to him in a tender way, cooking in front of him, being willing to care for him in that need, as she imagined that it was the case. In fact, what she cooks is repeatedly in Hebrew, in the verb and in the nouns, actually called love cakes. They apparently were little heart-shaped confections. It's a word only found in this chapter based on the word for heart. So she's baking little heart-shaped cookies. I remember when Janie once made some for me. I took it personally. I thought, well, okay, she likes me. It's not that she thought I was too thin. It was meant to show something more than that. She's so trusting and loving that when he asks everyone to leave, which should have been viewed as a questionable, sketchy situation, she stays there. But of course, he's pretending to be so weak that he can't even put food in his mouth. But nevertheless, there is affection on her part, and she is willing to reinterpret his over-aggressiveness, like my minister friend wife did on her wedding night, as completely idiotic. Or, this is, all men are cads, even the one I married. But they can be tamed and they can figure this out. Or she apparently was willing to somehow or other forgive him, because she says, sending me away would be a greater wrong than what you have already done to me. She's willing to forgive this grievous wrong. And the willingness of that reminds us of what he should have been doing, not hating her, but falling head over heels in love with her. We have one other story, and I want to use it to make a comment on this story. It's where the story comes out with a happy ending, even if it had a bad start. It's in Genesis 34, where Dinah, the daughter of Leah, born to Jacob, went out to visit the women of the land. She wasn't looking for trouble. She just wanted a walk in the park. She wanted to be with her girlfriends. Then Shechem, the son of Hamor, the Hivite, the ruler of that area, saw her. He took her, and he had his way with her. Looks like the story we've got here. Then it says, however, his soul clove to Dinah, the daughter of Jacob, using the very same language you have for marriage, where a man shall leave his father and mother and cleave to his wife. His heart, his soul in Hebrew, clove to her. He fell in love with her after he slept with her, after he was so inconsiderate and imposing his will on her. But he repented by how? Shotgun love. Not that there was a baby all of a sudden that they had to get married. It's that we slept together that we have to get married. I have to get marital love. I have to love you. And so he falls head over heels in love with her. It says his heart clove to Dinah. He loved the girl. And he spoke, and literally in the Hebrew, he spoke to the heart of the girl. Maybe it was 6 months of telling her how sorry he was and how wonderful she is and how her faith is so attractive to him. In fact, he converts. We know this. He converts. And all the other Shechemites all convert with him. He spoke tenderly, and then he tells his father. He's not keeping this secret. He tells his father, "Dad, please get this girl for me as a wife." Then he goes and speaks to her father. That must have been, I'd like to have a little video on that one. And he also talks to her brothers, because brothers protect sisters. That's the normal thing. They don't abuse them, they protect them. And the brothers listen, he said, "Let me find favor in your eyes, and I will give you whatever you ask. Make the price for the bride and the gift I'm going to give you as great as you like. I'll pay anything you ask. Just give me this girl for my wife." And by the way, it's not that he's paying them. All the money that goes to them then gets sewn into her dowry and goes to her. He wants to pay for the most expensive diamond to show how his intentions, whether mixed before, are utterly honorable now. That's how to repent. Fall in love. Win her heart. Be worthy of her love. And if she says no, you got what you deserve. If she says yes, you got what God often will work out in a marvelous way. The Bible tells us how to repent, and it starts the same way as it did with David. You say, well, there's no use. I have wrecked my life. You're talking about one instance. I've got a long list I couldn't even remember. Jesus never said to those who failed to live up to his standards, now your life is ruined. He never says that. Find it in the New Testament. It's not there. He says, go and sin no more. He says, come follow me. Follow a whole new master who has a very different view of sex because he invented it. You say, well, this is making way too much of sex. No, it's making the same thing of sex that God chose when he made it possible for a couple to have a baby with just one sexual act of intimacy. He apparently thinks it's very important. You can create an eternal soul from it. And so why not create a bond of love from it as well? Responding with the love that you depict in the bed of being one flesh. The way God views it is he sees you as committing yourself before him to this other person, to love him or her as your own body, as your own flesh, to love even as Christ loved the church, which is his body. Nathan messed up. David messed up, and Nathan was sent to him as a prophet to tell him he was the man. He was the sinner. And David's response is the same as ours should be. I have sinned against the Lord. Now, there may be many who feel like none of this applies to you. You haven't done this. You've never abused some woman. But you think, how do these things apply to you, actually? Many of us have failed in the responsibilities we had when we've had power over someone to use it in a self-sacrificial way rather than a self-serving way, where we have imposed our will on those that we treat like trash, like they're just objects, like they have no feelings, rather than recognizing that we're breaking their heart even as we're opening our mouths. We have often acted in ways that are designed for self-gratification rather than for the affirmation and love of others, whether it has to do with sex or not. Repent as David did. I've sinned against the Lord. And what does Nathan say? The Lord has taken away your sin. You're not going to die. The wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ. And that's what we're going to celebrate, the price for our redemption. You say you made your bed, you got to sleep in it. Well, no, you can ask God to remake your bed. Make it better. If he can only use the good decisions of your life to make things work out, he's got very little to work with. He can use the bad things. He works all things together for the good of those who love him, who are called according to his purpose, if you'll commit your life to him and let him lead you from this step forward. May we do so. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you that there's at no point in our lives that we can say that we've made a wreck of our lives and it's irreparable, because you're the God who has promised to make us new creatures in Christ. Behold, the old is past and all things have become new. We pray, Lord, that we would have a whole new mindset, even though it is utterly contrary to the culture in which we swim, that we would take your view of the sexual act of intimacy and recognizing how precious and good it is, and to live according to your life-giving precepts that will leave us with lives where we will have no regret. We thank you for the sake of Jesus, who gave his life that we might live for him. Amen. Mm-hmm.